Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Hello, everyone. Can we start now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So guys, today we are going to start surface chemistry, okay? And we'll finish this chapter today itself. And tomorrow or probably day after, we'll have one more class. So there, then we'll start P block in the next class. Okay, whenever we have, we'll let you know. Okay. First of all, let me share the screen. Can you see the screen now? Okay, so yeah, so surface chemistry is the last chapter of physical chemistry we have. Okay, we are left with chemical kinetics in this physical chemistry portion. So that we'll do in offline class, chemical kinetics. Okay, organic we have almost done. Amines we have finished, biomolecules we have done. Right, so there are a few chapters left in inorganic chemistry that we'll focus on. So surface chemistry, in this chapter, first of all, there are two, three things. The chapter is not that big. Okay. First of all, two, three things are very important here. And that is, in JEE, they ask questions on this chapter. Okay. It's not like the chapter is small and not that conceptually vast. They won't ask. They ask questions from this chapter in JEE exam. And the book you have to go through for this particular chapter is NCERT. They ask questions from NCERT itself. Okay, so you have to thoroughly read NCERT for this chapter. Okay. All those concepts which are there that we'll discuss, but NCERT you must go through. Okay, so let's start with the chapter we have. This surface chemistry is what it is. This chapter deals with the phenomenon that occurs at the surface or interface. Okay, so what we are going to study in this chapter, that it deals with the phenomenon or chemical process. Phenomenon or chemical process that occurs at that occurs at the surface. The process that occurs at surface, or we can also say, or the interface, or the interface of two phases. When two phase interacts, so that interface, what chemical process is there, what phenomenon is there, what is actually going on, that we discuss in this chapter. Okay, one type of process we have already familiar with, and that is absorption. We know this term properly. Okay, what is absorption and all? The another term here, we are going to introduce in this chapter, you must have heard about it, and that is adsorption. The basic difference of absorption and adsorption, you know already that adsorption is a surface phenomenon, and absorption is a bulk phenomenon. Okay. So what happens, adsorption, if I try to make you understand this particular process, the best example is, suppose you, if you take a chalk, okay. Suppose you have a chalk piece that we used to write on blackboard and all. This is a chalk piece and a foam, a sponge. Foam that we dip. Now, when we dip these two into a vessel which has ink into it, this is suppose we have blue, black, whatever color ink we have into this. When we dip this chalk piece into this ink, then what happens around the at the surface of this chalk, there is ink present, and this ink won't go into the bulk of this chalk. Okay, if you dip this for a few seconds, okay, but this sponge or foam, it is completely dipped with, or the ink molecule or particles is uniformly distributed in the entire foam or sponge that you have. It is completely occupied with the ink. Okay, so this is two different process we have here. The distribution of ink particle is uniform, that we assume, and here the distribution of ink particle is only at the surface, at the outer surface of the chalk piece that you have. Okay, so basically in technical term, if I say in this particular process, what happens, there is a difference between the concentration at the surface, concentration of what? Concentration of ink. Difference between the concentration at the surface and the bulk of the chalk piece. Okay. Concentration is different. At surface, we have more concentration, and in the bulk of this chalk piece, we have less concentration. Or minimum, or very small, the concentration value is very low over here in the bulk of this liquid. So this kind of process is nothing but adsorption, where the particles get accumulated at only the outer surface of the molecule. Got it? And this is what, where the particles are there at the outer surface as well as the inner surface, that we call it as sorption. Okay, sorption, you let it be. Okay, this I'll just come to this a few minutes later. Did you understand what is adsorption? Adsorption is what? Adsorption is the definition of adsorption, you write down. It is the tendency of adsorption. It is the tendency of accumulation of molecular species, accumulation of molecular species at the surface Right? This is adsorption. It is what, since the accumulation of molecules takes place at the surface, so adsorption is a surface phenomenon. Surface phenomenon. Okay. Now you see there are two types of molecule we have. If I talk about this surface here, suppose we have a surface like this, a molecular surface we have like this. Okay. In case of adsorption, what happens? The molecule which adsorb at the surface, here we have adsorption, right? These are the molecules which accumulates at the surface of outer surface of this particular molecule. This is adsorption. So there are two types of molecules we have. The one which adsorb at the surface, and the other type of molecule is what? The surface at which adsorption takes place. Okay. So to define these two molecules, the one which get adsorbed and the adsorption takes place on the surface. Okay. So two different molecule we have. The molecule where adsorption takes place on the surface, where adsorption takes place, is called adsorbent. Okay. So we define these two molecules by a term called adsorbent. Adsorbent. And the another term we use here is adsorbate. Adsorbate. Okay. Adsorbent, write down the definition of it. The material or the molecule, the material or the molecule at which adsorption takes place. So in short, if I write down the surface at which adsorption takes place. The surface at which adsorption takes place are called adsorbent, is called adsorbent. And the molecule which accumulates at the surface of adsorbent called adsorbate. Okay. So adsorbate are the molecules So adsorbate are the molecules which accumulates at the surface of adsorbent. Copy down this. Done.
No, one second, please.
Niranjan, KVPY is done.
Sir, finished morning itself.
How was it?
Very bad for me.
How about you, Gaurav?
Sir, I don't know, sir. I think I did okay.
Okay. Copy down first. Okay, can we move on? Yes, wait, Kavya, Andrew, Sana, wait for a minute.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Done. Okay. This three diagram you see, suppose this is a adsorb bet we have. Adsorbent. Another adsorbent is suppose this, and adsorbent is this, suppose we have. Three different arrangement I am taking here. This molecules are the molecules of adsorbent. Okay. The blue one is an adsorbent where the adsorption takes place. And this orange one is adsorbent, adsorbent. So this is the two possibility we have. And last one is this, where we mix the two possibility. Means the adsorbent molecule present at both surface and the bulk of this molecule. Okay, this process where the adsorbent, I'll write down here, this is adsorbent and the blue one is adsorbent. So if you see the difference in these three, the first diagram, it says that the adsorbent molecule present only at the surface. Second one, the adsorbent molecule present only on the bulk. It is not at all present at the surface. And third, to both kind of arrangement we have, surface as well as the bulk of the adsorbent molecule. So this process, the first one, is actually adsorption. This one is adsorption, where the molecule present only at bulk. This one is absorption. Absorption. And the last one is sorption. So practically the things that happens is sorption only. Sorption takes place. These two are the ideal condition we are assuming, right? It is not possible that when you dip a molecule into the dip an adsorbent into an adsorbent, then the chances are very less that the adsorbent molecule are present only at the surface or only at the bulk. But this probability is very high. Actually, this happens. This is the two ideal condition we are assuming, that when the adsorbent molecule at the outer surface, it is adsorption, only inner surface, absorption, and both is there, then sorption. Okay. So this actually happens practically. These two are we are assuming. Okay. This is one thing. This process, adsorption, it is an instantaneous process. Instantaneous process occurs very fast. It's a very fast process. Okay. Adsorption is a, like I said, it is a bulk phenomenon. And comparatively slow in nature. Okay. Sorption is a mixture of both. Adsorption plus absorption. Adsorption plus absorption. Okay. Like example is what? Dye on cotton fabric. On fabric simply, right? On fabric. That is an example of sorption. Okay. For adsorption, one technical thing also you have to keep in mind that we must, because like I said, we are assuming adsorption. Like in the first diagram, I haven't drawn any adsorbent molecule present in the bulk of this molecule, correct? But actually, there are few molecules present here also in adsorbent. So what we define here, that the concentration at the surface and in the bulk of this molecule, there must be some difference into that, okay? So concentration at the surface is high in comparison to the concentration in the bulk of the liquid, okay? So for adsorption, what we say, there must be a difference in concentration. Difference in concentration of adsorbent between the surface and the bulk of the molecule, and the bulk simply read on the short. Okay. Another thing here you see, write down the adsorption of gases on metal. This question they have asked in exam. The adsorption of gases on metal on metal surface is called occlusion. Okay, for example, H2 when present in the pore of platinum, this is an example of occlusion, and the hydrogen which is present in this, we call it as occluded hydrogen. So definition based question they have asked on this, what is occluded hydrogen? Like this they have asked question, okay? So H2 which is present here, we call it as occluded hydrogen. This is one thing. Okay. Can I go to the next page?
So just a second.
Yes, sir.
Now, the next we have to understand what is the mechanism of adsorption. So heading all of you write down. Mechanism of adsorption. See, there are, for driving force for this process, adsorption is the two things we have to consider. One factor is residual force. Residual or unbalanced force. And the second one is thermodynamic factor. See, I'm not dictating here anything to you. So whatever I'm writing it down, just you copy this, okay, in your notebook properly. And if you feel like, because I'll say everything. So if you feel like this point is important, you copy it down. Okay, just write it down. residual or unbalanced force. Okay. See what happens here. Suppose I'll take a water molecule. Okay. So assume this is the water molecule we have. This is the surface. This is the water molecule we have. Assume two molecules. I'm assuming two molecules here. One molecule, which is, suppose this side we have, all these are adsorbent molecule. Right? If this molecule comes closer to this adsorbent surface, this is adsorbent, this is water, adsorbent, and this is adsorbent molecule. So when it comes closer to this, so you assume here, suppose this molecule, it is true for all the molecules here. If this molecule present here at the surface of it, water, which is the adsorbent, okay? So the atoms which are close to this particular molecule, they will have an attraction, they will exert an attraction force on this molecule. So we'll have a force in this direction, we'll have a force in this direction, here. Means the net force will be in downward direction. Okay. But you assume a molecule here, which is in the bulk of this liquid, and around this will have water molecule present or any other molecule. It is completely surrounded like this. Okay. So all kind of force, if you consider here, which is acting in this direction, this force is getting balanced by this. This force is getting balanced by this. This force is getting balanced by this. So here what happens in this bulk of this liquid, if any molecule is present in the bulk of this liquid, there is no net force. No net force. Net force is equals to zero. That's why it is, balanced. But here what happens here, we have net force in downward direction. So all those adsorbent molecule, which is close to the surface of this adsorbent, will experience a net force in this downward direction, right? So because of this unbalanced net force, which is nothing but the residual force, unbalanced force, the adsorbent molecule is attracted towards the adsorbent molecule. Obviously, this force is not that sufficient, then this will overcome the force of buoyancy here, and hence the molecule won't go into the bulk of the liquid. So that condition we are not assuming. Adsorption is only possible when this force is sufficient enough to keep this adsorbent molecule at the surface of the liquid. If it is high enough, this molecule will go into the bulk of this liquid. That condition I'm not taking, we are not taking. So for adsorption, the condition is satisfied here, what? That the net unbalanced force is just sufficient enough to keep this molecule on the surface of this liquid. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Right? So now you see what happens if you talk about in terms of bond here. So initially there were no bond present between this molecule and the adsorbent molecule. Now when this, because of this attraction force, there is a kind of bond present between these two molecules, and all these molecules, adsorbent molecules, are attracted towards the adsorbent, correct? And bond formation is what? Bond formation is an exothermic process, right? So because of this attachment, this bond, some energy goes out in the form of heat, okay? And that is why this process, we call it as exothermic process. Am I clear with this? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Delta H less than zero. Okay? So this is actually, first of all, this residual unbalanced force because of that, only the molecule is attached to this adsorbent, so adsorbent molecule. And in this process, some energy goes out in the form of heat. And that is why the process is exothermic. How do you memorize this? You can assume this as a bond formation, and bond formation is always an exothermic process. Okay. Now, if I talk about entropy of the system, when this attachment takes place, entropy decreases or increases?
Increases, right?
Wait, no, entropy should.
Less than zero or greater than zero?
I get it. Increases.
What? See, the, now when the bonding takes place because of this unbalanced force of attraction, then the adsorbent molecule is not free to move. Its motion is now seized, hindered. Right? So entropy should be what? Delta S should be less than zero. Right? So write down this point here. When a gaseous molecule gas is adsorbed, when the gas is adsorbed, at the surface, adsorb, let it be, the movement of gaseous particle seized, and hence randomness decreases, means entropy decreases. So delta S for this process is less than zero. So for two process, what we can write that delta H is less than zero for adsorption. Delta S is also less than zero. So if I write down Gibbs-Helmholtz equation, that's delta G is equals to delta H minus T delta S. So for the process to be spontaneous, what is the condition we should have?
Low temperature.
Or what we can say, the magnitude of delta H means the energy increases here should be more than the magnitude of T delta S. And for this, we need to decrease the temperature. Okay. And we also say this theoretical question they ask. We also say that the adsorption is taking place by decrease in enthalpy as well as the decrease in entropy. Write it down. The adsorption is taking place by decrease in enthalpy and
so can you repeat?
The adsorption is taking place by decrease in enthalpy as well as the decrease in entropy. Okay. So adsorption mechanism we have discussed. Now there are two types of adsorption we have. Adsorption, there are two types. The first one is physisorption, or we also call it as physical adsorption. Physisorption or physical adsorption. And the second one we have is chemical adsorption, chemisorption or chemical adsorption. Okay, the basic difference between these two adsorption process is in physical adsorption, what happens? Write down the adsorbent molecules. The adsorbent molecule attached with the adsorbent molecule with weak van der Waals forces.
Sir, could you repeat it again?
Adsorbent molecule attached with the adsorbent molecule with weak van der Waals forces. There's a weak van der Waals force. And that's why we also call it as van der Waals adsorption. Okay. So this kind of adsorption is possible because of weak van der Waals forces. And hence, we also call it as van der Waals adsorption. Okay. There are two, three properties for this adsorption we have. Like, first of all, here we have weak van der Waals forces. In case of chemisorption or chemical adsorption, the reason of the attraction between adsorbent and adsorbent is chemical bond. Okay, means the adsorbent and adsorbent molecule are attached together by chemical bond. So here we have chemical bond between adsorbent and adsorbent molecule. And here we have van der Waals forces. Okay. Now you can easily compare these two. Like, we have weak van der Waals forces. So we can easily overcome this force. One thing I forgot to tell you here. You see this diagram. This process, when you have this adsorbent molecule present onto the surface, is adsorption. So if you remove this adsorbent molecule from the surface, it is the reverse process of adsorption, and we call it as desorption. Okay, reverse of adsorption is desorption. Okay,
hello? Desorption.
Yeah. Hello. Are you there? Hello.
Yes, sir, we're there. We can hear you.
Yeah. So reverse of adsorption is desorption. Okay. But this desorption process is not possible when chemisorption is there, because chemical bond is comparatively stronger. It is very difficult to reverse the process. Okay. So the second difference here is, first of all, the nature of bond is different. Here we have weak van der Waals force. Here we have chemical bond. The second difference is what? That this is a reversible process. Okay. Since we have weak van der Waals force. Okay. So we can easily overcome this force by increasing temperature a bit. Okay. So we can easily overcome either by increasing temperature or by decreasing pressure. That's why it is reversible in nature. Write down, either by increasing temperature or by decreasing pressure. So this is weak van der Waal force. We can overcome it, and hence it is reversible in nature. And this one is irreversible. Irreversible. And since there's a chemical bond, so this forms unilayer. This forms multilayer. Okay. Unilayer, multilayer. Can you tell me, we know, we have already discussed that there is some heat evolve in this process, adsorption. Yes. Can you tell me in which of these two processes the heat evolve is more? The amount of heat that comes out in this process, right?
I think chemical adsorption.
Why chemical adsorption?
Bond is formed. So it's a strong bond. So more energy is released.
Krishna.
It's a strong bond. So more energy is released.
I got Krishna there, no?
Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. Chemical bond is a stronger, right? The more strong bond forms, it means what? More energy comes out. So what we can say, the heat of adsorption here, it is more heat of adsorption and here we have less heat of adsorption. See why it forms multilayer. You see this diagram here. Suppose we have a adsorbent molecule like this. This is the adsorbent molecule we have. Okay. This adsorbent molecule will have adsorbate present on its surface like this. Okay. Since this is a weak van der Waal forces, because of, and this happens because of charge separation. So when this attached to this, this will have some charge on it. And this will also attract the another adsorbate particle, which is there present in the other layer, the next layer you can say. This will also exert with this. And that's why it forms multi-layer like this. Okay, because it is a van der Waal force. So the force of attraction depends on distance. So for a certain distance, the force of attraction will be there and hence it forms multilayer structure. Here what happens, there's a chemical bond between the adsorbate and adsorbent molecule. And once the chemical bond already formed, it forms a layer. Further with another layer, the bond formation is not possible because one bond is already formed. There's a bond between these two, chemical bond. So the another layer won't form into this because the chemical bond is already formed. It is not an attraction force so that the other molecule also get attracted towards it. That's why we have here unilayer and this side we have multilayer. Got it? If I give you the value here, which is not, you know, that important to memorize, but in this case, we get 20 to 40 kilojoule per mole of energy releases into this. And in this case, it is somewhere around 80 to 240 kilojoule per mole of energy releases. Okay. See, physisorption is not specific in nature. The another difference you write down, it is non-specific. Non-specific in nature, but this one is a specific because it forms a chemical bond, right? So we know between two atoms, like chemical bond will have a certain condition to be satisfied. That's why chemical bond does not form between all kind of molecules, okay, among all kind of molecules. But since physisorption is a force of attraction that only requires charge separation, right? That can also be possible with induced charge. Charge induction is also possible, no? That's why it is non-specific. It does not depend upon what kind of molecule we have. We just need charge separation. Correct? So this one, we call it as non-specific, and this one is specific. Okay? One thing also you must take care of in physics option, the amount of gas that adsorbed is directly proportional to the ease of liquefaction of that gas. Okay? Here write down the amount of gas adsorbed is directly proportional to the ease of liquefaction of that gas. Why I'm giving you this, and there is no such relation we have here. Here we cannot say liquefaction and amount of gas that adsorbed, the relation between that is not true here. But in this case, amount of gas adsorbed is directly proportional to the ease of liquefaction of that gas. It means what? If I ask you, there is NH3 and O2, two gases we have under similar condition. So which gas will adsorb more? What is your answer? The one which is easily liquefied, correct?
NH3, right?
Yeah, NH3.
Yeah, the one which is easily liquefied. And liquefaction tendency, how do we observe?
So we judge it by the force of attraction.
Force of attraction. And that is determined by the van der Waal constant. Correct? And what is that van der Waal constant?
A.
The force of attraction, A. So A value is more for polar molecule that we know already. Gases statement, we have done it. Revise it once. Okay? So with A value, actually, you can say that under the given set of conditions, which gas will adsorb more? Till now, they haven't asked this kind of questions. But since they haven't asked, they may ask this question. Okay, so keep that in mind. The gas which has more A value has more adsorption tendency, physical adsorption tendency. Got it? So here, the adsorption under similar condition of NH3 will be more than to that of O2. Got it? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, another thing which is very important here, like I said, it is reversible in nature, and with increase in temperature, this can go in backward direction. Okay? So can we say that as temperature increases, adsorption decreases for physical adsorption? Can we say that?
Could you repeat?
As temperature increases, adsorption decreases, physical adsorption. That's why I have written here, reversible in nature, and this nature we can achieve by increasing temperature or decreasing pressure. Okay? So graph of these two I'll draw in the next slide. Can I go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so physical adsorption, the graph is this. Chemical adsorption, the graph is this. This graph is X by M, and this is temperature. This is also X by M, and this is temperature. X by M is what? X is the amount of gas adsorbed. Okay? Amount of gas adsorbed per unit mass. X by M is the amount of gas absorbed per unit mass. The graph that we get here for physical adsorption, it goes like this. Physical adsorption, it goes like this. At constant pressure, as temperature increases, the adsorption decreases. The pressure is constant here. For physical adsorption, the graph is this. First increases, maximum value, and then decreases.
So the first graph is for physical adsorption, right?
This one is left side is physical, right side is chemical.
Okay.
Here also the pressure is constant. And constant pressure graph we have. So this graph we call it as adsorption isobar. Both graphs, we call it as adsorption isobar. Okay. Chemical adsorption, what happens as temperature increases? Okay. Process is exothermic, temperature increases. So the amount of gas that adsorbed increases goes to a maximum value. And then it started decreasing because every bond, it gets strong with the value of temperature to some extent. If you increase the temperature, then the bond becomes weak. It can dissociate easily and hence the adsorption decreases. So chemical adsorption, this graph is experimental, but with this graph, we can conclude what? That first, the amount of gas that adsorbed increases goes to a maximum value. Then the bond becomes weak and adsorption decreases and hence the graph is like this. Okay. So what we can say in chemical adsorption, the magnitude of adsorption initially increases and then decreases. The magnitude of adsorption increases initially goes to a maximum value and then decreases. Chemical adsorption is this. Here, since we have van der Waal force, so with increasing temperature, the attraction becomes weak, hence it decreases continuously. Okay. Okay, can we move on next? This actually, the same thing we have for the factor affecting the rate of adsorption or adsorption. So next topic we are going to discuss here is factor affecting adsorption. Factors affecting adsorption. So the first factor, temperature, we have already discussed. So I'm not discussing it again. Okay. Temperature we have discussed already. Okay. Next, write down the surface area of adsorbent. As the surface area increases, as the surface area increases, the magnitude of adsorption increases. Okay, more surface area, more adsorption. Okay, and all these, we are talking about physical adsorption. Must you take care of that? This is physical adsorption. Right, nature of adsorbent, you write down. Nature of adsorbent. We have also discussed this, that the gas which has more value of A, the gases which are easily liquefiable, write down like this, the gases which are easily liquefiable get adsorbed easily. More, liquefaction tendency, more will be the adsorption for the gases. Nature of gas is this. Pressure, you write down. At constant temperature, the magnitude of adsorption increases initially and then becomes constant. At constant temperature, the magnitude of adsorption, physical adsorption, increases initially and then becomes constant. One, the small thing you write down here, which is not here, factors affecting, we are done. See, when you plot a graph, write down one note here. A plot of temperature versus pressure. Temperature versus pressure. For a given amount of adsorption. Is called adsorption isoster.
So for a given amount of?
For a given amount of adsorption is called adsorption isoster. Okay. So basically, when you draw a graph between temperature and pressure, for a given amount of adsorption, the graph is called as adsorption isoster. This adsorption isoster, it is a straight line like this. Once they have asked question onto this, like they have asked, what is adsorption isoster? So it is a straight line graph drawn between temperature and pressure for a given amount of adsorption. This you just keep in mind, adsorption isoster. Okay, like adsorption isobar, when the graph is drawn, drawn at constant pressure. For a given amount of adsorption, the graph of temperature and pressure is adsorption isoster. Okay, and one more thing we'll see here, that is adsorption isotherm. This is most important out of the three. Write down the heading, adsorption isotherm. All these things we are discussing for adsorption of gas over liquid, gas over solid, where gas is what? Gas is adsorbent. And liquid is adsorbent. Okay. Adsorption isotherm. Write down. It is a variation of amount of gas absorbed with change in pressure at a given temperature. Change in pressure at a given temperature. Okay. The most important graph we have here, and we call it as Friedlich adsorption isotherm. So write down this. Write down into this. The graph of this, the definition is this only, the amount of gas adsorbed with change in pressure at a given temperature. Okay. The graph here is this is X by M axis. X is the amount of adsorbent. M is the mass of adsorbent. Okay. So this X by M is the amount of the mass that adsorbed per unit mass of adsorbent is X by M. And this side, the axis we are taking as pressure. So at constant temperature, the graph that we draw here, or we get like this. Okay. Friedlich adsorption isotherm, it gives us a relation of the amount of gas adsorbed per unit mass of adsorbent and pressure. And this relation is given by X by M is directly proportional to the pressure P to the power 1 by N. It is just based on observation. Okay, there is no proof of it. The statement, this is given by the scientist called Friedlich, where this n is always greater than 1. So 1 by n, the value lies in this range, 0 to 1. Okay, and this graph is true only for Fizzy's option.
What is n?
N is the number, like I said, always greater than 1.
Number of what?
Are any number, 2, 3, 4, anything.
So, sir, for given physics option, n will be defined, right? Like for given media.
Yes, yes. You don't have to actually calculate n, but the point is the variation of the amount that adsorbed per unit mass of adsorbent is not always directly proportional to pressure. Okay. It is actually an observation. Okay, like let me explain this first. What we write here at very low pressure, you can also, you know, discuss this. At very low pressure, it is found to be the amount that get adsorbed per unit mass of adsorbent X by M is found to be directly proportional to pressure. Okay, and that is why you see here till this point, it is a straight line till here, right? It is a straight line. So for this reason, we define the relation as X by M is equals to some constant K into P. But when you further increase the pressure, okay, the graph goes like this. It makes a curve till here, which looks like a curve here. So for this graph, what we can write for this reason, X by M is found to be P to the power 1 by N. And for this reason, this, since it is almost parallel to the x-axis we have, so at very high pressure, what we can write, X by M is directly proportional to P to the power 0, which means it is independent of pressure. So what we can say, to conclude this discussion, what we can say that at low pressure, the mass that adsorbed per unit mass of adsorbent is directly proportional to the pressure that we are using. At moderate pressure, the relation is X by M directly proportional to P to the power 1 by N. And at very high pressure, the mass that adsorbed is independent of pressure. These three things you need to keep in mind.
One second.
Let me know once you're done.
Done.
Okay.
Okay. Right, so this is the three things. They ask this question very direct. Privilege adsorption isotherm is important. Okay, this is one of the things that if you want to revise in the last 5 minutes, this chapter, you should go through this. Okay, this is one of the things. So Friendlich adsorption isotherm is important. You'll get some numerical question also into this. Okay, these three conditions you must remember. Another thing is, when you have this for moderate pressure, if you take log both sides, then what happens? We'll try to establish a relation between two. At moderate pressure, we can write X by M is equals to constant K P to the power 1 by N. And when you take log both sides, log of X by M is equals to what? 1 by N log P plus log K. Is it fine? Now, can you tell me the graph of log of X by M and log P? the graph will be like this. It is a straight line.
It's a straight line with the slope of 1 by.
Yeah.
What is this distance?
Log k.
Log k. The y-intercept is log k. And the slope of this line is what? 1 by?
1 by.
N. So sometimes they give you graph like this. And they'll ask you what is the value of k, what is the value of n, all this. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. One more thing that we have observed, you know, practically is when you draw a graph, at different temperature. All these graphs at constant temperatures, we call it as adsorption isotherm. Okay, constant temperature graph. Three different graphs we get here. Suppose one graph is like this. The another one is this. And one more is this. It is around 0 degrees Celsius. This is around minus 29 degrees Celsius, and this is minus 78 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now, this axis is x by m, and this is pressure. Okay. So, for a given amount of adsorption, okay, suppose this. For a given amount of adsorption, this is the amount we have. At this temperature, minus 78, what is the pressure we have? This pressure we have something, suppose P1. And this pressure is P2. Okay. What you can conclude from this graph?
For a given pressure, as temperature decreases, adsorption increases.
Temperature decreases, adsorption
increases.
Adsorption increases for a given pressure.
Yeah.
Achha, one more.
For graph. A given pressure, yeah.
One more thing I'll draw here. This line you assume. This line. In this case, we are getting different amount of gas that adsorbed, right? So for a given pressure, as temperature increases, this is the temperature increasing, right? Minus 78 to zero. For a given pressure, as temperature increases, the amount of gas that adsorbed decreases, fine? Minus 78 degrees Celsius, this is the amount of gas adsorbed. For the same pressure, minus 29, this is the amount of gas adsorbed. At zero, this is the amount of gas adsorbed. The amount of gas that adsorbed at a given pressure, right, decreases with increase in temperature. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Right? And if temperature you are increasing for a given amount of adsorption, this blue one I am talking about, if temperature you are increasing for a given amount of adsorption, you have to increase the pressure also to maintain the same, you know, adsorption. Clear? So
yes,
on
sir.
These two variations,
yes,
they may ask you theoretical question. They may frame the question. There are four options. You need to think about it. So best way is to keep this graph in mind, okay, and then you can conclude both the question you can do. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the first part of this chapter we have. Adsorption, absorption, we have discussed. Okay. All these things that we have discussed, I am not going to write this again. I'm just giving you the similarity in this. All these things that we have discussed so far, it is the adsorption of gas on solid. Keep that in mind. If you haven't written it, write it down. Gas on solid we have discussed so far. That's why we were talking about the liquefaction thing, value of A and O. Okay? Similar thing we have when we consider the adsorption from solution phase. Okay? Adsorption from solution phase. The only difference is what? For gaseous phase, we have pressure in this. This expression contains this pressure. When you are talking about the adsorption from solution phase, instead of this pressure, we have what? We have concentration of solution. Is it clear?
Sir, adsorption of solution on solid, right?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Understood.
So write down this point, adsorption from solution phase. Heading you write down, just 2-3 lines you write down, we'll move on then. Adsorption from solution phase. Important one is this, gas on solid. Okay, but the similarity I'm just giving you, write down. The process of adsorption takes place from solutions also. Takes place from solutions also. It is observed that solid adsorbents adsorb certain solutes. Adsorb certain solutes. Adsorb certain solutes from solution in preference to other solutes and solvents. Example, you write down the litmus solution. There are many things you must have done, but you haven't observed this. That is the process of adsorption. Example, the litmus solutions, when shaken with charcoal, becomes colorless. Okay, the example is the litmus solution, when shaken with charcoal, becomes colorless. Another example, the precipitate of MgOH whole twice attains blue color When precipitated in presence of magnesium reagent MAGNASON magnesium reagent. It is actually an indicator that we use, not that important. But it is a kind of indicator we use. Okay. So the expression of adsorption, the amount of adsorption in solution phase with respect to the Friedlich adsorption isotherm will write here. X by M, everything is exactly same. We'll get k c to the power 1 by n, where c is the concentration. C is the concentration. You know buttermilk? Huh?
Yes, sir.
Buttermilk, actually in villages, what happens? They used to sell this thing. They used to prepare this and sell per glass. There are some 5-10 rupees is there. So sometimes what happens, the buttermilk, if the amount of salt is very high or amount of salt is more over there, to reduce the amount of salt into this, they put 2-3 pieces of coal into it, in the mixture. Okay. So that coal absorbs the solute, that is, absorbs the salt which is present into that buttermilk. And hence the amount reduces and the test is comparatively better.
So that's solid on solid adsorption, right?
Yes, that is solid. I'm just giving one example.
Yeah, okay.
That is solid and solid. Even in that's a part like we used to say when you cook something, right? And if the amount of salt is more by mistake, you put 1-3 pieces of coal into it. That will reduce the amount of salt into it.
So third is to put potato.
Huh?
I thought you used to put potato for it to adsorb.
Potato we have starch present into that. No. So it produces some sweet to that mixture. In that way, the amount of salt won't reduce, but it gives some sweetness to the test. No, that's why it feels like amount of salt is less. But adsorption, there is an example actually, that when you put that coal pieces into that buttermilk, right? So that coal pieces adsorb salt from that buttermilk, and hence it reduces the amount. But that's a different thing. I'm just giving you this example so that you can correlate and keep that in mind. Okay, so all these are examples of adsorption. So anyways, 2-3 things are there. Friendlich adsorption isotherm is the most important, whatever we've discussed so far. Okay, they ask questions onto this numerical, they may ask you onto this line, graphical based question they can ask. Okay. Difference of physical and chemical adsorption is also important. Okay, like I said, multilayer, unilayer, and the pressure relation, reversible, irreversible, many things. In board also, they ask that what is the difference between physical and chemical adsorption. So all those things are important. Now, the next thing we are going to discuss here is colloids. What is this? What are colloids? Don't know. See, I'll take here three different mixture. 1, 2, and 3. In this 3 beaker, I put water into it. All these are H2O. H2O, H2O. Okay, so what I do, here I put salt, NaCl into it. Here, sand. And here, milk. What is the difference in these three? In this solution, what happens? After some time, when you put salt into it, you look at this solution, you won't see any salt particles present into it because it dissolves completely. Okay? Here, what happens? This becomes muddy, right? You can see the violet color over here. And this, you cannot even see, you cannot even understand that there is water also present into it when you mix this milk into it. The point is, these three are three different kinds of mixture we have. Okay. So to understand colloids, we have to understand first what is a true solution, and from true solution, how do we get colloids? and then how do we get suspension? Okay, to understand this colloid and suspension, okay, true solution is what? True solution is defined for homogeneous mixture. Yes or no? That we have discussed already.
Yes, sir.
Water and NaCl forms homogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture are those mixture in which there is only one phase present. And that is when you mix NaCl into it, you can see only water present into it. And hence we can say only one liquid phase we have here. Only one kind of phase present mixture is homogeneous. But that is not true in these two cases. Okay. Here we have sand plus water in this. Another thing you can understand, like for uniform concentration, just tell me one thing. You have one solvent here, say water, and when you put very small amount of solute into it, whose size is also very small when you put into this. And in the second case, you are increasing the size of the solute particle that you are putting in. So what happens with very small size, okay, the tendency to get settle is less or more. Suppose I am taking two examples here. Both beaker has water present into it. Okay. And here I have put few solutes into it with very small size. And here the size of the solid particle is like this. If I ask you, in which of these two mixture, the tendency to get settle is more?
The second one, right? The one.
Second one, right? And why this settling takes place? Because as size of the particle increases, the force of gravity also increases onto the solute particles. And hence it has more settling tendency. Okay. Here what happens when the size is less, force of gravity which acts onto this particle is also less. And the liquid molecules, the solvent molecules that you have, that also, you know, collides continuously with this molecule in all directions. Because of this collision, it keeps on moving here and there in the mixture. And hence the tendency to get settle is very less. And that is why there are high chances for this mixture that it may form a true solution, which is a homogeneous mixture. But if I ask you whether we have the tendency for this mixture to form a homogeneous mixture, the chances will be less because the size of the particle is less and it has more force of gravity it experiences. And hence the tendency to get settled down is more over here, right? So what is the difference in these two mixture is the difference between the size of the solute particle, okay? So we must have a range of the size which forms a homogeneous mixture. And then when it settles down, it forms another kind of mixture. And then when again, if you increase the size, it gives you another kind of mixture. So based on the size of the solute particles, the mixtures are classified into three categories. One is true solution, next one is colloids, and next one is suspension. Okay, so write down next thing here, that based on the size of the solute particles, based on the size of solute particles, the mixture has tendency to form, the mixture has tendency to form homogeneous or heterogeneous mixture, right? And on this way, we define three types of mixture. One is solution, that is true solution. And then when you increase the size of the solid particles, it forms colloids. Further, if you increase the size, it forms suspension. So for solution, the size of the particles must be less than 1 nanometer. Then it has high tendency to form homogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture. When the size of the particle, solid particle, is less than 1 nanometer. Colloids forms when the size of the particle is greater than 1 nanometer, but less than 100 nanometer. In this range of solid particles, colloid forms. For suspension, the size is greater than 100 nanometer. This is for suspension. Okay. So when the size, it is observed that when the size of the particle is more than 100 nanometer, then the force of gravitation dominates and hence the settling takes place. It settles down. Okay, so we are now trying to put focus on colloids. Okay, we're trying to understand this colloids. Okay. The definition of colloids you write down. A colloid is a heterogeneous system. I'll write down here. It is a heterogeneous system. Heterogeneous system in which one substance is dispersed as very fine particles of another substance, another substance called dispersion medium. Okay. It is a heterogeneous system in which one substance is dispersed as very fine particles of another substance called dispersion medium. This is again as very fine particles in another substance, not of. Sorry, in another substance called dispersion medium. So if you compare this with solution, okay, solution, if you do this comparison, solution, there are two components. One is solvent, other one is solute. Okay, similarly, in colloids, we have dispersion medium and dispersed phase. If you try to compare this with solution, so solvent is equivalent to dispersion medium in colloids and solute is equivalent to dispersed phase in colloids. Got it? Okay, so whenever we discuss about heterogeneous system, then we won't use the term called solvent and solute, but we use dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Correct? Now you see, like, solutions are classified into 9 different categories depending upon what the phase of the solute and solvent. Like, it may be solid, liquid and gas, like that. Okay, so similarly, this colloids are also classified into different categories depending upon the physical state of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Okay, so next heading you write down, classification of colloids. Classification of colloids. And this classification is based upon the physical state of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. And dispersion medium. Okay, so I'll draw a table here. All of you draw this table. We have dispersed phase and we have dispersion medium. Name of the colloids, and then some example. Dispersed phase okay, dispersed phase can be solid, it can be liquid, and it can be gas. Okay. Now, when dispersed phase is solid, dispersion phase okay. So if this phase is solid, phase means what? It is equivalent to solute over there. Medium can be solid, can be liquid, and can be gas. Solid plus solid, the name of the soul that we have here, we call it as So solid plus solid, the name of the colloid that you get here, its name is solid stone. The example is gemstones. We can write, we can also write some colored glasses. Gemstones, colored glasses. Solid plus liquid, we call it as soul. This one is important. This one is important, soul. Solid plus liquid is soul. Example is, we have glue, starch, we can have paints. Glue, solid plus gas, the name is aerosol. And its example is smoke, dust. Liquid, with liquid, we can have this as solid. So liquid plus solid, we call it as gel. Liquid plus solid, we call it as gel. Example is cheese, butter, etc. Liquid plus liquid. The name is emulsion. Any example of emulsion?
So that's sulfur.
Hair cream. Liquid with gas.
There is paint and emulsion.
Paints is an example of soul. In NCERT, paints they have given as emulsion. In NCERT, I guess paint.
Which one should we follow?
Sorry?
Which one should we follow?
I think because when you read some higher books, paints is an example of soul. Okay, it's not an emulsion. So I think in school exam, better you should follow, I think you should follow NCERT only.
Yes. Okay.
Sir. School exam, you should follow NCERT only. Don't write paints as in soul. Solid plus liquid plus gas. Liquid plus gas, the name is what? Is the pen. The name again, we call it as aerosol, liquid plus gas. The example of this liquid plus gas aerosol is cloud, fog, mist.
Sir, foam, right?
Foam is not. Foam is this thing. Foam is gas in liquid.
Okay.
Foam is gas in liquid. Gas with solid, we call it as solid foam. Solid foam. Example of gas in solid we have. Okay, gas in solid. Solid soul you write down, not foam. It is solid soul. Solid soul. Example is fumic stones. Fumic stone. You can take foam rubber. Gas with liquid is foam. Example is leather, froth. Gas plus gas, this form is not possible because this gives a homogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture. Okay. So in this soul and this emulsion, you must remember. Okay. this is the classification of colloids based upon the phase of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Okay. Second type of classification, which is again important, and that you write down, classification based on the nature of interaction . All of you done this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So now we're doing classification based on?
I'll write down. Classification based on the second type. Based on interaction between dispersed phase and dispersion medium.
How much more left?
There are few things we need to understand here. Today we'll finish this, Sushant. It's theory.
Sir, I think that was Niranjan, not me.
Niranjan? Okay,
yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, write down. Quickly write down. Depending upon the nature of interaction, colloids are classified into two categories. Colloids are classified into two categories. Can you tell me the first one? Have you heard about lyophilic?
Yes, sir.
What is lyophilic?
Favorable towards oils and basically not water.
Non-hydrophilic.
Is it non-polar?
Yeah.
Lyophilic colloids are those colloids which are attracted towards the dispersion medium. That's why it is lyophilic. Another one is lyophobic. Okay, so definition of this you write down. These are the colloids which are attracted towards the dispersion medium. Dispersion medium means what? It is equivalent to solvent that we have in solution. Dispersion medium. Write down, these colloids can easily be formed. These colloids can easily be formed by mixing of substance like gum, gelatin.
So wait, did you just say gum, like the chewing gum?
Oh, no, not that gum, that glue.
Good idea.
Hey, ugly, anyone asked you?
Okay. Gum. What did you write? Gelatin. Starch, rubber, etc. Starch, rubber in a suitable liquid. See, there are two things, lyophilic, like I said, and another one is lyophobic. Okay, lyophilic and lyophobic. Lyophilic colloids ke liye, we don't have to do anything. Just you need to mix the substance with a suitable liquid. You'll get lyophilic colloids. Okay, but lyophobic colloids, it's not very easy to get this lyophilic colloids. we have some preparation method, we have to have some add some different substance into it. So to understand this lyophilic, like as far as the importance is concerned, lyophilic colloids are not that important. Lyophobic is more important. Okay. So the next one you write down. The next line in this, the important properties of these salts The important properties of these salts means lyophilic colloids or lyophilic salts is the dispersion medium can be separate out
so could you repeat that
the important properties of these salts is that the dispersion medium can be separate out from the dispersed phase by evaporation. And hence it is reversible soul. You got this point? And hence it is reversible soul. Means what? Suppose gum and or starch, if you put into any other liquid, like suitable liquid, the thing we have to keep in mind that the size must be in the range of colloidal solution, which forms a colloidal solution, right? If that size is there, starch, you mix with liquids, it forms a lyophilic colloid. When you heat this little bit, the dispersed phase and dispersion medium can be separated out easily, okay? And when you again mix this, you'll get colloidal solution, lyophilic colloidal solution. So this thing is what? This thing is reversible in nature. Okay. So lyophilic colloids are reversible in nature. This is one very important point we have here. The next one you write down, lyophobic colloids, the second one. Lyophobic means what? Liquid, which hates liquid. Okay. So lyophobic colloids are not attracted towards the dispersion medium. Lyophobic colloids are not attracted toward, these are the colloids which are not attracted towards the dispersion medium. Hence to prepare this we have to use some special method. These colloids, next line write down, these colloids are easily precipitated by addition of a small amount of electrolytes, comma, by heating or by shaking.
Sir, can you repeat?
What I said, that these colloids are easily precipitated by adding small amounts of electrolytes by heating or by shaking. And hence these are not stable. Okay, these are not stable. Next line. Once precipitated, they do not give back the colloidal soil. They do not give back the colloidal soil by simple addition of the dispersion medium. Once precipitated, they do not give back the colloidal soil by simple addition of dispersion medium. Hence, they are irreversible soils. Okay. So lyophobic colloids, these are not attracted towards the solvent or dispersion medium. So we cannot mix the dispersed phase and dispersion medium to get these kind of colloids, because the mixing is not possible. Okay. To get this kind of colloids, we have to have some special method of formation of this. And that will discuss the preparation method of colloids. Okay. Difference you must know. Okay, the first one, lyophilic, is reversible. This one is irreversible. The another difference, if you see, the viscosity of lyophilic soil is much higher than the viscosity of dispersion medium. Okay, but in case of lyophilic colloids, the viscosity is almost similar to that of the dispersion medium. Okay.
Sir, lyophilic it's higher, lyophobic it's
lyophilic closer. Is higher, lyophobic is close to the dispersion medium. Okay. Coagulation, you know what is coagulation? Precipitation? Coagulation is the precipitation, you know, right? The precipitated forms. The same thing is coagulation also. Coagulation and flocculation. I'll write down this thing later on. Okay. Lyophilic colloids are quite stable. Okay. So write down just one last point in these two. The precipitation of lyophilic colloids is difficult. The precipitation of lyophilic colloids is difficult, but that of lyophobic colloids is easier. Okay, so this is the two classification we have based on the interaction between the dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Okay. One last type of classification you see, the third one. Which is classification based on the type of particles present. In this, we have three types of classification. The first type we have, I won't give you much theory into this. Okay, it is not important, the first two. Multimolecular colloids. Just one line you write down into this. Multimolecular colloids. This forms when large number of atoms, large number of atoms or smaller molecules. The size must be smaller. See, types of particle present. So we are considering the size of the particles here. Overall, the size must fall in the range of colloidal particles, okay? Smaller molecules aggregate to form a species having size in the colloidal range. This is one thing, not important at all. I'm just moving off. Example, right? On sulfur sole consists of around 1000 S8 sulfur molecules. This is multi-molecular colloids. The second one in this we have macromolecular colloids. Okay. In this, the substance having large molecules. Okay. So large molecules are dissolved in suitable liquid. Right, this is the condition, suitable liquid. Condition is what overall? That the size must fall in the colloidal range. Okay? Example of this is, you know, there are two things. One is naturally occurring and other one is synthetic. So naturally occurring macromolecular colloids are, just example you must keep in mind, this is like I said, it is not at all important. Okay. Starch, cellulose, protein, enzymes. Are natural occurring. Synthetic one is right down nylon, rubber, polythene, etc. Can you go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
One second. Yeah, okay.
The third type, see here, which is important, and that you must have heard about this, associated colloids. Have you heard this, associated colloids? No? Have you heard this, missiles? Missiles you must have heard, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right down into this. There are some substance which behaves as this, the third one is important, okay, which behaves as N behaves as a strong electrolyte. Electrolyte at low concentration. Low concentration. But as concentration increases, they shows colloidal property behavior, since they due to formation of aggregates. Okay, due to formation of aggregates. This aggregates particles, when this they combines together, this aggregates particles are called micelles, associated colloids. Okay. Now you see there are two things into this. This you must remember. Only definition you have to memorize. There are two things. Like formation of micelles due to formation of aggregates, which is known as micelles. Write down the last thing, which is known as micelles. Formation of micelles won't take place at all temperature. For that, you must have one temperature. You must have the whole process to form micelles. You must have one minimum temperature, okay? So the two condition we have here, that is temperature, minimum temperature must require, and minimum concentration also must require. Because what I said here, low concentration, it is an electrolyte. But when concentration increases, it behaves as an colloids, micelles. So what is that minimum concentration? The minimum concentration, we call it as CMC. CMC, write down, it is critical micelle concentration. It is a minimum concentration above which aggregation takes place. Critical micelle concentration, CMC. It is a minimum concentration above which aggregation takes place. The minimum temperature we need here, and that temperature we call it as Kraft temperature. Have you heard about this Kraft temperature? That we write it as TK. It is a temperature.
Sir, can you repeat what the full form of CMC is?
Critical micelle concentration.
Yeah, okay.
Kraft temperature, you write down, the formation of micelle takes place above a particular temperature, and that temperature is Kraft temperature. Okay.
Sir, if there's a lot left, can we have a break, small one?
You want break now? Yeah, there are things left into this. We have to discuss.
Anytime convenient, you can give break.
Can you give a break now? My back is hurting.
What's the hell? For a wrong class. This is not physics.
Oh, God. Shit.
What? Tell me.
So you give and you want to give.
Time, sir.
Okay, chalo, we'll take a break. Okay. Will it start at 4:30?
Fine, sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So can you just repeat that last point about Kraft temperature?
Kraft temperature is the minimum temperature above which the formation of micelles takes place. CMC, critical micelle concentration, is a minimum concentration above which, again, formation of micelles takes place.
Yes, sir. Got it. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Take a break. 4:30, we'll start, guys. Hello. Can we start?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we discussed about the missile formation, right? See, actually, in missiles, what happened? How this missile forms, the mechanism we have. For example, the soap we take, right? Soap is nothing but what? Soap is the sodium or potassium salt of higher fatty acids. For example, if you take this the molecular formula C17H35 COO minus Na plus. This is the formula of soap. Okay. Now, in water, what happens? This exists in the form of ions. Okay. CO minus Na plus will be out. So this exists this way. Suppose we have this CH3, CH3, and last we have here C double bond O, O minus. I'm just writing this to make you understand. Okay. This C17S35 will be here, and this is the ion you get. This part, CO minus, we call it as hydrophilic part. Hydrophilic, why I'm calling it as? It is same as lyophilic. Lyophilic term we use when the solvent is not water. Okay? When the solvent is water, lyophilic becomes hydrophilic. Right? This is polar also. So polar one is attracted towards the water molecule, hydrophilic. This one is non-polar. And this part is hydrophobic. Okay. We also call it as hydrophobic tail. And this is hydrophilic head. Got it? Okay. Can I go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
So this soap has actually two parts of it. One is hydrophilic. Other part is hydrophobic. Okay. So when you put this into water, okay. So water, we have, suppose this thing. Okay. So the hydrophilic part is into the water like this. And hydrophobic part is out of the water, means away from the water molecule. Away from the water molecule. So I should write this as, it's not a straight line, this way. Again, we have negative. So this, all these negative thing is hydrophilic and this is hydrophobic part. Okay. At CMC, what happens? CMC is what? Critical missile concentration. At CMC, all these anions are pulled into the bulk of the solution and they aggregate to form a spherical shape. Okay. At CMC critical missile concentration, anions are pulled into the bulk of the liquid. And forms a spherical shape. And forms a spherical shape with their hydrophobic part is pointing towards the center of the sphere. A spherical shape in this, the hydrophobic part towards the center of the sphere. and then it forms a missile. So missile formation is this only. So we have the diagram. If I draw, it is like this. This is the spherical shape we have here. And all these ions, okay, it is this is the hydrophobic part pointed towards the center of the sphere. All this is COO minus, 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 COO minus. Okay. So this alkyl group or the hydrophobic part, it's pointed towards the center of this sphere. And this we call it as missile or ionic missile. Okay. The hydrophobic part, it has affinity towards the oil droplets or grease molecule that you have. Dirt, dust, whatever it is there. So how it works, because it is a soap, right? So we know the fabric has cross-linking of polymers like this, we have, suppose. In the fabric, we have cross-linking like this. Suppose we have some oil particles or grease particles here at this, or any point we are here, we have. So what happens, this missile, the hydrophobic part, makes a bond with this oil or grease particle that you have here. So around this, what happens? Around this, the hydrophobic part is towards this oil droplets that you have. It surrounds like this. Like this. Here we have COO minus, COO minus, CO minus everywhere we have. Okay. It makes a bond with this oil droplet. And hence, finally, what happens with the cloth, it takes this oil particles or oil droplets with it and wash away with the water, okay, with water. That's how it works in the cleansing. This is actually the cleansing action of soap, okay?
So basically, you need a minimum amount of dirt to be washed away.
Not minimum amount. Minimum amount, if the dirt amount is less, then you require less amount of soap or detergent. Even detergent also works in this way. See, you must have seen this. If the clothes are very dirty, you required more detergent to clean that. Okay. If the number of clothes are more, then in that ratio only, you required the amount of detergent. Okay. So that's how it works. Basically, it forms a missile, and the hydrophobic part has affinity towards the oil droplets, grease, or dirt that you have, dust that you have there in the clothes. It makes a bond with this oil droplets or grease, and then it washes away with the water molecule. Okay. In one missile, this kind of missile, it actually contains 100 such ions. 100 such ions. Got it? Can we go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Formation of colloids, like I said, preparation of colloids. There are 2-3 methods we have for the preparation of colloids. One is dispersion method. Other one is condensation method. There we have exchange of solvent and all. Dispersion method, there are 1-2 things which are important. Okay, dispersion method. So in this, write down preparation of colloids, heading you put. Preparation of colloids. The first one is mechanical disintegration. Mechanical disintegration in this, what we do, see, whatever colloids we have to prepare, okay, it actually carries out in a machine called colloid mill. Okay. In colloid mill, what happens? It consists of two discs, steel discs. Okay. And there's a gap between the two discs. Okay. And they can rotate in an opposite direction. You can assume one disc on the top, one disc on the bottom. There is a bit of a space between the two discs, and both are rotating in the opposite direction. Okay. So we need to disintegrate the molecules, and we have to get the size which is required for the collision colloidal particles. Okay. So our objective is what? We have to disintegrate the molecules and get the size which is required to get the colloidal solution. And to reduce the size, we are using this colloidal mill. Right? So what happens? This disc is rotating in a very high speed. Okay. Now the solid material with which we, if you want to form the colloid, that material will put into the gap between the two discs, and the disc is rotating in an opposite direction, so the solid particle that you put in, it dissociates or disintegrates into the smaller particle. Okay, and then we'll mix this with a dispersion medium, right? Dispersion medium, and we also add a stabilizer into this mixture, which stabilizes the colloidal solution. Okay, so right down into this, we have this colloidal mill. Okay, the solid particles, write down, the solid particles or material is disintegrated with the help of colloid mill and then mixed with the dispersion medium.
So can you repeat?
The solid material is disintegrated with the help of colloid mill and mixed with the dispersion medium to get the colloidal mixture, to get colloids. Next line, a stabilizer is often added to stabilize the colloidal solution. Okay, but this method is not that useful. The another one, and the important, a bit more important, is the electrical disintegration. This is mechanical disintegration. Here we have electrical disintegration. And electrical disintegration, we use actually the potential difference. We have to have a, we'll have a electrode, and that will connect with the PD. Potential, we'll connect with the voltage source, basically. So electrical disintegration, this rule, we also call it as, this method, we also call it as Bredig's arc method. Just 2-3 lines you write down here, Bredig's arc method. This method is used for the preparation of colloidal solution of metals like silver, gold, platinum, etc. Silver, gold, platinum, etc. Okay. What we do into this method, that we'll do the, we use the method of electrolysis actually. The metal of which the colloidal solution has to prepare, okay? We'll take that as an electrode for this purpose. And corresponding to that, we'll take the dispersion medium also here. So this is connected to the external voltage source, right? And suppose we have to form silver colloids, right? So we'll take silver rod as the electrode here, okay? What we do when we connect with the high voltage source, right? It gives a very high amount of electric arc here. Electric shock, you can say, it produces. So because of that, some metal elements here, the silver elements here, it get vaporized, okay? Because of that high electric shock, you can say, or electric arc, you can say. The metal elements here, silver elements, get vaporized, okay? And since it is kept into the cold water here, chilled water also we use. This is chilled water or cold water, you can say, okay? So when it vaporizes, it is dipped into the water, okay? So as soon as this vapor, silver vapor, comes into the contact of this chilled water, it gets condensed, and that gives you the colloidal solution here. Okay? So what happens? Due to electric arc, write down quickly into this, due to electric arc, electric arc, some atoms, some metal atoms, converts into gaseous form, and when it comes into the contact of chilled water, it gets condensed. And when it comes, when it comes into the contact of chilled water, it gets condensed. And that gives the colloidal solution of that metal. Okay, one thing you must keep in mind, that metallic sol means when you prepare a sol with metals, metallic sol are negatively charged. This charge you must have to keep in mind. This is the most important part of this, are negatively charged. I'm coming to this charge part, charge thing now, but you have to keep this in mind, that metallic sol are negatively charged always. Because when it comes, forms the vapor and then it condenses, it grabs some electrons also into this. That's why it becomes negatively charged. Okay, so this is Bredig's arc method. How to form colloidal solution that we are discussing. But all of this, the most important part is that the metallic sol are negatively charged. Okay. There is one more method of preparation we have of colloids, okay? Third one, which is the most important out of the three. The third one is peptidization. It is defined as the process of converting a precipitate, freshly prepared precipitate, into colloidal sol. into colloidal salt. So from precipitate, we are trying to prepare the colloid in this method. So for that, what we do, and for this purpose, we use an electrolyte. I'll write down this in a symbolic way. We'll use an electrolyte. Electrolyte, which has one common ion. Which has one common ion. So suppose, for example, if I take the precipitate as AgI. So from AgI precipitate, if you try to form a colloidal sol, then in this you have to mix one electrolyte which has at least one common ion. Okay, so what we can do in this, two way we can prepare the sol into this. We can either use AgNO3 or we can also use Ki. Is it clear? AgNO3, either we can mix AgI with AgNO3 or we can mix AgI with Ki. These two are electrolyte. Okay, and in peptidization, the process, like I said, what is the process? Is the process of converting a precipitate, freshly prepared precipitate, into a colloidal solution. Okay, and to do that, we use an electrolyte. The condition of electrolyte is what? It must have one common ion. So AgI is the electrolyte, suppose. Then we can take AgNO3 as an electrolyte or Ki as an electrolyte. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what happens here, you see, the property of this, the electrolyte that you have, the precipitate that you have, AgI, okay, it gets surrounded by the common ion here. So common ion, if you add AgNO3 is Ag plus, so it is surrounded by Ag plus, like this, Ag plus, Ag plus, Ag plus, Ag plus, and Ag plus. Okay, and this finally disintegrates into the colloidal range. Into the colloidal range, because for colloids we must have the range of the particle size must be there in that range. Okay, disintegrate in the colloidal range, and we get a colloidal solution. Here, when you add Ki into it, then what happens? We'll have AgI precipitate, and it is surrounded by what? Surrounded by
I minus.
It is always surrounded by the common ion that you have. I minus, I minus, I minus, and I minus. And finally, in this also the same thing happens. It disintegrates in the colloidal range. Right? But when you add AgNO3 and Ki, the charge of the colloidal solution is different. Since it is surrounded by the positive charged ion, it is positively charged. Positively charged colloid, and this is negatively charged colloid. Okay, understood this? This is the most important part of the entire colloidal discussion that we are doing. Negatively charged colloid or negative colloid. Is it clear? Tell me fast. We don't have that much time. We'll go a bit faster.
Yes, sir. It's clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Colloids are, I'm going towards the next thing. See, whenever you prepare like this, or this is the peptidization method we have discussed. Even method is something else. Then because of some, you know, collision between the dispersion phase and dispersed phase and dispersion medium, all the colloid particles will definitely have some charge. Okay. It is always there. Thing is what? The two points you need to memorize or keep in mind, the colloids are always charged. There will be some charge, and it is not like positive, negative, both charges present. It will be either positive or negative. Okay. And we say colloids.
Why does Shravan become the host every time Sir leaves?
Yeah.
So wait, now what do we do? You just texted 2 minutes.
Where?
Group.
Oh, what's up?
Wait, the Gaurav that joined is not Gaurav sir.
Hey, admin, you have host, you should know.
I just said Gaurav.
All...
Hey, Shravan, what all can you do as host?
I can share screen and that's it. I can't do anything extra.
Even I can share screen.
Yeah, but... Yeah, you can. I can record.
What are we doing?
Dude, his laptop date.
Shravan, share your screen and show us what you're watching right now.
Nothing, I'm watching. I'm watching the thing. I can even unmute people.
Oh yeah, Dheeraj sir always does that.
So are we just gonna like sit here?
Where do you have to go?
Make me the host.
Oh, sorry, join. Okay.
So the problem is if I leave, it'll make someone else the host. I don't know who it'll make, but I'll leave and show you.
Okay, go ahead.
Hey, no, you can make someone the host.
Yeah, you can. Whosoever is a host, you can, you know, make anyone the host. Anyway, so we were discussing what? We were discussing colloids are always charged, okay? When I say colloids are charged, I am talking about colloids particle, okay? Colloids particle means what? Dispersed phase, not medium. Dispersed phase, not medium, okay? All these colloid particles are either positively charged or negatively charged. Okay, either positive or negative. It is not possible that 2-3 particles are positively charged and 2-3 particles are negatively charged. Both not possible, either positive or negative. Okay, that's why you see this colloids are, we also say that they are stabilized by repulsion or by repulsive force. So write down the next thing. Colloids are stable through repulsion. What do you mean by this, stable through repulsion? Suppose you have a colloidal particles here in this vessel. We have liquid molecules and colloidal particles. And in this colloidal particles, we have some colloids particles present which are supposed negatively charged. Okay, negatively charged. First of all, the size is not that enough so that these particles get settled. Okay. And since they are negatively charged, so they repel each other continuously in all directions. All these particles are repelling each other continuously in all directions. That's why they move in zigzag manner in through the entire solution. Okay. The reason is because of charge, they are repelling each other. Hence, they are moving here and there in zigzag motion. Second thing, we'll have collision between the dispersed medium and dispersed phase also. And that's why they continuously move entire in all directions. Okay. And this movement, we call it as Brownian movement. Okay. So this is the property of colloids. They have Brownian movement. Brownian movement means what? They'll move like this. Randomly in any direction. This is Brownian movement. Okay. Why they are stable through repulsion? Because negative, negative or positive, positive charge repel each other. That's why they are continuously moving into solution, into the mixture, and hence they are not getting settled. Understood this?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
One thing you must take care of in peptidation, the electrolyte that you are using, that must have one common ion. That is very, very important. If common ion is not there, then colloid solution won't form. Okay. Now the thing is, suppose by any means, if you destroy this charge, I'm moving to the next point. If you destroy this negative charge, then what happens? Then there won't be, there is not any Brownian movement. There won't be any repulsion, right? And then it starts settling down. Okay. That is one property we have there. But when charge is not there, repulsion won't be there. And they have tendency to come closer and aggregates. Are you getting it?
So none of this will happen if common ion is not there.
No. First thing is what? Peptidization. For peptidization, we need an electrolyte which has a common ion. So you get colloids now. Okay. And we know colloids are stable through repulsion. Okay. And why repulsion is there? Because colloid particles have same charge, same kind of charge. Positive at the plus, 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 plus two at the plus two, plus two, plus two, minus to minus, minus, minus. Understood this? So when you destroy this charge on the colloidal particles, if you destroy this, then all these colloidal particles have tendency to come closer. Are you getting it? Because there is no repulsion now. So all these particles have tendency to come closer and they aggregates, forms a large particle, and that actually destroys the colloidal property of the mixture. Is it clear? Tell me.
Yeah, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when the charge,
yes, part,
when you destroy charge, particles come closer, aggregate, the mass increases, hence force of gravity also increases, and hence there will be a tendency of settling. Correct? This settling of charge particle, we call it as coagulation, flocculation, or precipitation. Is it clear? Right? When this coagulation, precipitation, or flocculation, all three things are same, right? So write down the heading.
Wait,
next.
Coagulation, precipitation, and what?
Flocculation, I'll write down, wait. Three terms we have, which are the same thing. Coagulation, precipitation, or flocculation. Write down into this quickly, write down. The stability of lyophobic soles is due to the presence of charge on colloidal particles. the stability of lyophobic soles is due to the presence of charge on colloidal particles. Since all the colloidal particles, are considered to have the same charge, same kind of charge, even in magnitude also they have equal charge, same charge, hence they are stable through repulsion. By any means, if the charge is removed, the particles comes closer to each other, and form aggregates, and eventually they start settle down due to the force of gravity. Next line, the process of settling of colloidal particles is called coagulation. Understood this coagulation?
Yes, sir.
Now this coagulation is possible by two, three ways. You don't have to, don't need to go into that detail. Only one thing is important here that we'll see. The first method, by electrophoresis. We can achieve coagulation by these four methods. Electrophoresis, R-E-S-I-S. Electrophoresis, in this what happens, there is actually, we introduce a two electrode into it. And then when you apply potential difference, okay, there will be movement of charged particles towards the opposite charge electrode. Okay, so electrophoresis is the phenomenon of movement of colloidal particles under an applied electric field. Okay, so if you have the colloidal particles present in this vessel, suppose positively charged or negatively charged, whatever it is. If you take an electrode here, apply with a potential difference, okay, if it is negatively charged, then it starts moving towards the positive electrode like this. And it accumulates here, and hence the, you know, the coagulation takes place because a charged particle won't be there in the solution. So electrophoresis is not at all important. The point is, it is a phenomenon in by which when an electric field is applied in a colloidal solution, then the charged particles present in the colloidal solution starts moving towards the opposite charge electrode, and hence the colloidal property is lost of the solution. Electrophoresis is this. Another way, boil colloidal solution, again you can achieve coagulation. The third one is boiling, we have done. Or suppose if positive charge colloid we have, so by mixing of oppositely charged colloids, did you understand these three?
Yes.
Charged colloids. If you mix opposite charged colloids, then they'll cancel out each other and there won't be any charge present, and then it starts settling. Okay. The most important method we have to achieve coagulation, precipitation, or flocculation is the addition of electrolyte. On this, they ask question in the exam. Addition of electrolyte. So tell me, if you have positively charged colloids, okay, then we need negative charge to destroy the positive charge. Our objective is to achieve coagulation, we need to destroy the charge present in the colloidal particles. So if positive charge is there, so we need some negative ion to destroy the charge. If negative charge colloidal particles we have, then we require positive charge to destroy the negative charge. Okay. Now to understand this, we have a rule that we call it as Hardy, H-A-R-D-Y, Hardy Solje rule, S-T-H-U-L-G-Z-E, Hardy Solje rule. According to this rule, what we say that one simple thing you need to keep in mind, it's very easy that you can easily understand it. Greater the valency of active ions, write down, greater the valency of active ions, we also call it as flocculating ion. Flocculating ion means what? The ion that we are using to for this process, coagulation. Flocculating ions. Greater the valency, greater will be the coagulating power. Is it clear?
Sir, these ions are those that we add to the colloid, right?
Yes, to destroy its colloidal property.
Okay, sir, understood.
Okay, so can you tell me negative charge colloid if you have? So we need positive ions to destroy the colloidal property, correct? So if I give you these three ions, can you tell me the order by which they can destroy the colloidal property? Suppose we have K plus. Suppose we have Mg2 plus and Al3 plus. Which of these ion provides maximum coagulation?
K plus, right?
Al3 plus.
Al3
plus. More valency, more will be the colliding coagulating tendency. So negative charge colloid, if you have, then Al3 plus will destroy more. This is the order of coagulating nature.
So just take magnitude of charge, right?
Yes, magnitude only. More positive charge, more coagulation.
Well, amongst Al3 plus and then what's the next one there? Gallium, something like that.
Gallium is the same group, no?
Okay, so
Vision, you don't have to think much here. Only you see the valency. That is what Hardy Solje rule.
So more what about Na plus, K plus, CS, RB plus, etc.?
See, Na plus, K plus will have the same power. We are just looking at the magnitude of it. Simply in layman language, what you can say, one positive charge will neutralize only one negative charge. So two positive charge will neutralize two. Three will neutralize three, like that. You can see. So if you have positive charge colloids, and I'm giving you, suppose, three ions, which is, suppose, Cl minus we have, SO4 2 minus we have, and PO4 3 minus. Then which one will give maximum coagulation? PO4 3 minus, right? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes? You just need to check, you just need to check the magnitude of the charge over there. Okay. But the thing is, if you do not know what is the charge on colloid, then how can you decide whether you have to take positive ion or negative ion? Are you getting me? You to select these ions, because they'll ask you this, which will produce maximum coagulation. Okay, they'll give you one sole. Suppose they'll give you a hydroxide sole, okay, FeOH whole thrice, or suppose they'll give you metal sulfide sole. Like the question is, for metal sulfide sole, which of these ion will use for coagulation? So you should first know what is the charge on metal sulfide. Are you getting me? Okay, so this part you need to memorize. Okay, there are some general trend I'll give you. Like the positive charged sole, first one you write down. Positive charged sole. This one again, very, very important. The coagulation power and all, very important. Hydrated metal oxide you have. Hydrated metal oxide. This much you remember, you can do all the questions. First condition is this. Hydrated metal oxides are positive charged sole. For example, if I give you Fe2O3.xH2O, hydrated metal oxide, positive charged sole. If you have Cr2O3.2H2O, hydrated metal oxide, positive charged sole. Human blood is also positive charged sole. Third one is TiO2. It is also metal oxide, positive charged sole. Negative charged sole is metal sulfides. All metal sulfides are negative charged sole, like As2S3. Metal sulfides. Soles of heavy metal, like I said, silver and all. Soles of heavy metal. Metal soles are negative charged soles, colloids. Soles of starch, gelatin, etc. So this 2-3 information you must have. Which one is positive charge, which one is negative charge. Once you know this charge of the sole, you can easily find out which ions we should use, positive ions or negative ions, to destroy the colloidal property. Okay. Now, if the order is given, more positive ion, more positive charge, more will be the coagulating tendency. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, yes, the sir. Next thing in this, because when you boil the colloidal solution, it loses its colloidal property, right? To protect colloidal property, what we should do? So next heading you write down, protection of colloids. Protection of colloids. See, for protection of colloids, what we do, lyophilic soles are more stable. More stable than lyophobic. Because what happens in lyophilic soles, you have an electrolyte here and it is surrounded by the water molecule because it is water lovers. So these are surrounded by the water molecules. And when it is surrounded completely, all those charged species won't have that the capability to attack onto this colloidal particles and destroy it. Okay, so this is lyophilic. Since it has a layer of water molecule here, water molecule, or you can say dispersion medium layer we have here. Okay, so because of this layer, and why this layer is there? Because it is lyophilic, attracted towards the dispersion medium. Okay, so this, we have a layer of dispersion medium here. That's why the electrolyte has very less tendency, or electrolyte is not enough powerful so that it can penetrate this layer of dispersion medium and then destroys the colloidal particle here. That's why lyophilic soles are more stable than lyophobic. Now, to make this stable, to reduce the coagulation, what we do, we add lyophilic sol into the lyophobic sol. Okay, so write down into this. Since lyophilic sols are more stable, hence we can add lyophilic sol. Hence we can add lyophilic sol to the lyophobic sol. To the lyophobic sol to protect its colloidal properties. To protect its colloidal properties. So what happens into this? Next line, write down. The particle of lyophilic sol. The particle of lyophilic sol surrounds the particle of lyophobic sol. Surrounds the particle of lyophobic sol. Hence, coagulation becomes difficult. Done. Hence, the coagulation becomes difficult. And that is the reason lyophilic sol is also known as protective colloid. Am I clear with it?
So can you repeat the first line once? I'm sorry.
Is the first line? The particle of lyophilic sol surrounds the particle of lyophobic. That's one. Yeah.
Yeah.
The particle of lyophilic sol surrounds the particle of lyophobic sol. Hence, coagulation becomes difficult.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, there is one more term here. The last thing we have to discuss here is how to find out the strength of protective colloid. We should know that which colloid is, what is the strength of each and every colloid so that we can use according to their strength. Okay. So strength of protective colloid, write down this heading. Protective colloid. Okay. The strength of protective colloid, to determine the strength, we'll use a term and that we call it as gold number. Okay. It is the number of, write down the definition of gold number, all of you. It is the number of milligrams of protective colloid. It is the number of milligrams of protective colloid. That will prevent the coagulation of that will prevent the coagulation of 10 ml of a gold sol on the addition of 1 ml of 10% NaCl solution.
Wait. Coagulation of 10 ml of gold sol on gold addition.
Sol on the addition of 1 ml of 10% NaCl solution. Okay. So reference is gold sol. Definition you again go through. It is the number of milligrams of protective colloid that will prevent the coagulation of 10 ml of a gold sol on addition of 1 ml of 10% NaCl solution. Okay. If I give you one protective colloid, suppose we have protective colloid one, protective colloid two. For this protective colloid, the gold number we have, and which is 10 milligram is the gold number. For this, the gold number is 20 milligram. Can you tell me which one is a better protective colloid?
Sir, one, right?
So one, the first one.
Why? Because it needs, it requires less mass, yeah. Right? Less mass. So it is, this one is the better colloid. So less mass you require, it means it has more, you know, power. That's why the first one is a better protective colloid. Okay. There are some molecules for which the gold number is given. I'll just write down here. You copy it down. The first one we have gelatin. Its gold number is 0.005 to 0.01. Hemoglobin. Egg albumin. Egg albumin 0.08 to 0.10. Potato starch. Is 25. Worst. Starch. It's 25 to 50.
Well, okay. Difference between potato starch and normal starch.
Yeah, even I was about
to. Okay, so this thing you have to memorize. Now the last few things we have to discuss is
so we have to memorize all these.
No, not like just you have this idea of like hemoglobin is a better, you know, gold is a better protective colloid than egg albumin. Okay. Gelatin is also even better than this. Okay. So at least two, three, like this, some, you know, comparison, you know, value don't memorize because you never know. I have seen this question in a NEET exam. They have asked which one is the best protective colloid, like that they have asked. Okay, that's for that purpose I have given today.
Yes.
But JEE, there are less chances they'll ask this. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So last thing we have to discuss here is Tyndall effect. What is Tyndall effect? It is the optical properties. See, Brownian movement that I gave you is the mechanical property of colloidal solution. Okay. Optical property is the Tyndall effect. Write down this heading. T-Y-N-D-A-L-L. Tyndall effect. It is the optical property. Tyndall effect is nothing but the scattering of light. Write down. It is the scattering of light by the colloidal particles in a colloidal solution. It is the scattering of light by the colloidal particles in a colloidal solution. Okay. This is the question that they asked so far. What is Tyndall effect? One of the options will be scattering of light. Done. But little bit more we'll discuss here. Next line, write down. If a strong beam of light is passed through a colloidal solution, a strong beam of light is passed through a colloidal solution placed in a dark place, the path of the beam gets illuminated.
So can you repeat?
this, if a strong beam of light is passed through a colloidal solution placed in a dark place, the path of the beam gets illuminated. This illuminated path is called Tyndall cone. This illuminated path is called Tyndall cone. You must have seen projector, right?
Yes, sir.
So in the dark room, when the projector, if you see the light coming out from the projector, you can see the path of the light beam, correct?
Yes, sir.
That is the scattering of light from the dust particle that is present in the room. So that is Tyndall effect actually. Even if you have a dark room, correct? And you make a small hole into the wall so that the light comes in from the outside. Okay. You'll see the dust particle and you can clearly see the path of the light beam.
Yes.
Right. That is also Tyndall effect. Okay. So this is what they have asked so far. What is Tyndall effect? That is it. One question that they may probably ask because they haven't asked yet is the condition of this Tyndall effect. Means what are the conditions to be satisfied to show the Tyndall effect? Okay. The first condition you write down, just write down condition, the first point. The diameter of the dispersed particles, is not much smaller than the wavelength of the light used. Means the point is, in like short way, what you can say, the particles, the diameter of the dispersed particles is not much smaller than the wavelength of the light used. See, why scattering takes place? That is only possible when the particle, colloidal particles, and the wavelength of the light, particle size and wavelength of the light that you're using is comparable. Then only scattering takes place. So that is one condition. Second one is the refractive index of the dispersed phase. The refractive index of the dispersed phase and dispersion medium must differ greatly in magnitude. Refractive index of the dispersed phase and dispersion medium must differ greatly in magnitude. Done? Written? Yes.
So can you repeat that last point?
The refractive index of the dispersed phase and dispersion medium must differ greatly in magnitude.
Sir, it's not like the dispersed phase should be lesser or anything. They should just differ.
Well, that difference is not required. Means that if it is same, then diffraction won't be there. Then the scattering won't be there. That's
so
why
I just have a doubt. I mean, why won't, so we are talking about scattering as in like refraction and all that, right?
Not exactly refraction. Scattering. Okay.
So why does it have to be, why does a difference have to be there? Such a great difference have to be there. That's my question.
See, the thing is, if the difference is not there, okay.
Yeah.
Then suppose we have two things, dispersion medium. So one will deflect the light in some different direction, like scattering will be there because of that.
Or something like mesomeric compounds.
Yeah, like that only. If you don't have much difference, then that will nullify each other.
Fine.
Okay. So, and this condition, you see the most important part here, this condition is satisfied by lyophobic colloids. Got it? Lyophobic colloids. Then there are high chances that they ask you, which of these colloids shows Tyndall effect, lyophobic or lyophilic? Answer will be lyophobic colloids, because in lyophilic colloids, the difference in magnitude of refractive index is not that much. It is almost to zero or very small differences there. Okay. So lyophilic colloids does not show Tyndall effect. Got it? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Last two things we'll discuss. See, emulsion and all, there's only definitions. Okay, so I'm not doing that. Okay, so you can go through NCERT, it is given over there. Definition of emulsion and an example. I'm leaving that, okay, because there are two more things I need to finish today, because that's what I'm taking now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, there is, like I said, Hardy-Suze rule you can apply once you know the charge on the colloid. Okay. So one thing is very important. Few examples I have given you. When you take FeCl3, this is very important. You must remember FeCl3. And you add excess of water into it, H2O excess. What you will get? You will get FeOH whole thrice plus HCl. Okay, so this ferric oxides FeOH whole thrice if water is excess. Water is excess, then this one is actually gives this FeOH3 and it is surrounded by Fe3+. Okay, water, if you are taking, it is surrounded by Fe3+, and hence it is a positively charged sole. This you must remember, positively charged sole. Ye tumhe yaad rakhna padega, theek hai? It is a positively charged sole when FeCl3 with H2O we have. But if you are taking FeCl3 with NaOH, okay, it again forms FeOH whole thrice with NaCl, but this is now surrounded by OH minus. So in this case, it is a negatively charged sole. So this you must remember, negatively charged sole. Okay, with NaOH and with H2O. When you solve the questions also, if you get some other sole which is not written here, you must note it down. Okay, because the charge you must know on the sole.
Yes, sir.
The last thing we have to discuss here is electrokinetic potential, or we also call it as zeta potential. See, if you have AGI, an electrolyte. Okay. AGI, sorry, it is a PPT we have precipitate. And when you add Ki, an electrolyte, into it, then what happens? This AGI is surrounded by what? surrounded by I minus common ion.
I minus, sir.
Common ion, correct? So like this, it is surrounded by the common ion AgI with I minus, AgI with I minus, and so on, right? So basically, we have silver iodide precipitate surrounded by I minus like this. I minus like this. And since there is also K plus present in the solution, okay, so this I minus also attracts K plus towards its side. Possible? I minus and K plus interaction. Okay. So the first layer that you get here, this layer, because around this we have K plus, if I write down this way, this side, we have K plus and K plus. So this layer, okay, when the combination of two layers of opposite charge around a colloidal particle is called Helmholtz electrical double layer. So this layer is electrical double layer, or simply electrical double layer, you can consider. Okay. And in this, the two layers are separated. Okay. This layer, the first layer that you forms here, this we call it as fixed layer. It is fixed. And this one is diffused. This layer that you form this side is diffused layer. Right? And we always know this thing is always true when two charged particles are surrounded by, right, some distance, there must have some potential difference. Correct? In the potential difference between the fixed layer and the diffused layer is called what? Zeta potential. Understood? Write down the definition.
It potential is
between the fixed layer and diffused layer. Zeta potential is the potential difference between the fixed layer and diffused layer. Understood? So just we have definition of it, electropotential, electrokinetic potential, and zeta potential. Just you need to keep this in mind. This is it for this chapter. Okay, like I said, NCRT you have to focus on. Okay, they form questions from NCRT for these chapters. Okay, so main focus on NCRT, go through it completely, properly. Okay, and then for solving questions, you can refer any other book. I'll share the assignment also on this. Okay, but we have discussed many things. The important thing I'll tell you again, physical chemical absorption, the key point you must remember. Okay. Colloidal thing, gold number, how precipitation takes place, charge on colloids, all those things are important.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Tell me.
Why do we consider colloid as a surface phenomenon?
Colloid is not a surface phenomenon, Sushant.
Then why do we start in surface chemistry?
No, surface chemistry, actually, you see, when colloid forms, you see that it is not a surface phenomenon exactly, but when you have that that precipitate AgI and you put some electrolyte onto it, then between I minus and AgI there is some interaction, right? So when yes. The surface, when the two phases are there, or at the interface, what kind of interaction is there? How they interact with each other? That is what we are discussing. So in soap, what happens? In soap, there is again the interaction between the hydrophilic part and and oil and grease. Again, two phase we have. Hydrophobic part and oil and grease. Hydrophilic part with water. Okay. So always you see there is an interaction between the two phase or particles we have. So surface chemistry, we study about when at interface or when interaction takes place, what is the chemical change we have? how energy change, how, you know, the process or the system goes towards stability. All these things we'll discuss over there.
Yes, sir.
So that's how it is. And even you see in zeta potential, we have interaction at the interface. Ions accumulate both sides. So that will, you know, generate a potential difference. That's how, that's what it is, zeta potential and electrokinetic potential.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is it. We'll wind up the class here. Okay. For next class, we'll let you know when it will possible.
Sir, have we finished biomolecules or that nucleic acids we study by ourselves, right?
Nucleic acid, if you want, you can study. I usually don't teach that. Okay. Because it's biology. If you want, I can take for half an hour. It's not that big thing also. We'll see. Next class, we'll see what to do. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
No, no, that's because he already left. But yeah.
What happened, Srijan? Hello?
He thought he ignored him.
Okay, chalo, bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you, sir.